Does having more sexual partners kill your chance of a happy marriage?
Did you know if you sleep with more than 5 guys, your chance of a happy marriage after 10 years goes from 80% to 25%?
That video has over 5 million views. She goes on to explain the scientific reason.
Because the more men you sleep with, you lose your ability to bond with each one.
Pairbonding.
Yeah, it's pairbonding.
That sounds like a science term. She must know what she's talking about.
So if you sleep with one guy, you're going to compare the next guy to him. If you sleep with 10 guys, you compare all 10. If you sleep with 20, you compare all 20.
Sounds reasonable, sensational, controversial, perfect for going viral. But is it true? Welcome back to What the Science, Sex Edition, where I do deep dives into the science behind viral videos, or lack thereof. To start, let's separate out the 4 components of her claim. But I didn't notice 4.
You have much to learn, my disciple.
Let's go from the specific to the general. Right off the bat, she opens herself up for trouble. If you sleep with more than 5 guys, your chance of a happy marriage after 10 years goes from 80% to 25%. That's very specific. This makes it more likely for the audience to believe her, because such specific numbers obviously must come from a very clear source. But it's also easier to fact check, theoretically.
Man, that's easier said than done.
Second, she narrows it down to just women.
If you sleep with more than 5 guys.
5 guys. You could say she may have meant the other side as well, but her whole conversation was focused around that specific dynamic. Third, there's the broad claim that more sexual partners before marriage decreases your chances of a happy marriage. Fourth, she gives 2 somewhat overlapping reasons for this claim, along with a specific term.
That's pairbonding.
Yeah, more on that later. So,
let's start at the very beginning.
Let's look at this first claim. We need to ask 4 questions. Does it make initial sense? Where did these numbers come from? Is it a reliable source? And what do other sources say?
Does it make sense?
My entire reason for making this video is that this highly specific claim failed my Fermi estimate.
Wait, what's that?
Back when the first atom bomb was tested, physicist Enrico Fermi was famous for dropping a few pieces of paper as that initial shockwave hit. Then using some very rough calculations, he was able to calculate that the estimated strength of that bomb was 10 kilotons. It ended up being 20 kilotons, but that's still a very close estimate. These back-of-the-envelope calculations are now referred to as Fermi estimates. And getting good at them is really useful for setting up misinformation warning bells in your head. So when I first saw this, my first thought was that if the divorce rate is currently 40 to 50%, and the average number of women's sexual partners in their whole life is around 4, these numbers are technically possible, but it would require some very strangely shaped graphs. It's a massive jump. So where do these numbers come from? I spent 2 days searching everywhere for her source. Those numbers were so specific that they had to come from somewhere. She, of course, never cites anything. And my guess was that she probably heard that stat from some random interview, and then the ballpark number stuck in her head. But if they're not exact, it makes it really hard to search. At first I gave up, but then halfway through my writing and filming process, I struck gold. And then had to
start at the very beginning.
Her scientific source isn't Nature or The Lancet or any other peer-reviewed journal. Instead, it's this, the Book of Charts from the Heritage Foundation. Probably. It's still not 100% clear. Specifically, Chart 15. Take a look. There is a lot to unpack here. At first glance, it seems like she might have a legit case. Women who had more partners are less likely to have stable marriages. There's that 80% number for no non-marital partners. And if you average all of the 6 and up numbers, you get something close to 25%. But we are scientists.
We are not children here. We are scientists.
And there are so many ways that this falls apart. First, she made a clear distinction for below and above 5 guys. As you can see, there's a sharp drop after 0, but then a pretty gradual decline. 2 and 4 are almost the same. There is no magic number. Second, she said your chance of a happy marriage, not a stable marriage. Stable is an interesting word.
Sir, it's quite possible this asteroid is not entirely stable.
Let's look at what it means here. Women aged over 30 that have been married for over 5 years. That's very interesting, because by this definition, not being in a stable marriage does not mean that your marriage is not going well. Just that it hasn't been 5 years. It could have been 7 years and it's going terribly. But you're still together for the kids or the Russians. So let's think about how they got these numbers. This first number is really just comparing 2 groups. Which is more likely? You being over 30 and married for more than 5 years, and never having slept with anyone before your husband, or you being over 30 and still a virgin? Surprise, surprise, the marriage thing is more common. Similarly, these are just saying that if you've slept with more than 5 guys over the course of quite a few years, you're less likely to have found the right guy yet. But she didn't say stable marriage, she said happy marriage. And this same document does have a graph relating your number of premarital sexual partners and your happiness. For women. It's not as big of a difference. But as before, if more partners means less likely to have found the one and settled down, then yeah, it sort of makes sense. So, this whole document is from the Heritage Foundation. But
is this from a reliable source?
They got their raw data from the CDC's 1995 National Survey of Family Growth, which included 10,000 women aged 15 to 44. Seems legit, but 1995. You want to know some other things that have changed a bit since 1995? More couples living together before marriage, and probably doing other things together, and more widespread use of contraception, especially in forms like IUDs. So what is the Heritage Foundation? It's definitely not a peer-reviewed journal, but do they have any sort of agenda that might be influencing their analysis? Here's one article I found on their website. Yeah, and also this. I'll let you do with these what you will. I like to stay away from politics. Moving on. Let's look at some other sources. In my initial search, I kept getting articles like this Atlantic piece citing this blog post from the Institute for Family Studies, which analyzed data from the CDC's General Social Survey. And the analysis is a lot more even-keeled. At first glance, it did find that more premarital sexual partners are linked to lowered marital satisfaction. And here they actually asked about happiness in marriage. None of this stability stuff. But let's look at the actual numbers. Do you see any 80% to 25% sudden drop? Around that 5-partner marker, maybe? I don't. Instead, it seems like there's a roughly 10% drop going from 1 partner all the way up to 21, with some interesting bumps in between. Of women with more than 11 partners, 57% still reported very happy marriages, compared to 52% in the 6 to 10 range. And note that if a trend really does exist, it's pretty much the same for men as well, with a steady offset across the board, which some research posit is because men are sometimes worse at picking up on subtle social cues, and therefore they might not realize if their relationship is not actually going as well as they think. This study showed evidence that women are more likely to initiate a breakup or divorce for that very reason.
Paul, I'm breaking up with you.
I'm breaking up with you.
I'm breaking up with you!
I'm breaking up with you. It's over.
I'm divorcing you, George.
Back to the survey. Of that total sample, only 3% reported being unhappily married. 5.3% of the more than 20 partners group reported this, compared to 2.8% for the whole less than 20 partners group. Yes, that's more than double, but those numbers are still pretty small. Comfortingly so. And all of this is missing the biggest problem. When it comes to observational surveys like this one, you can never just assume causation. Let's talk confounding variables. The claim here is that sleeping around ruins a woman's ability to bond with future partners, so don't do it. This claim is supposedly supported by data that we just saw. But just showing that the people who had more sexual partners tend to have less happy marriages does not mean that the one causes the other. Just like the dropping divorce rate in Maine is probably not caused by the decreased margarine consumption. What if some of the folks who have more sexual partners are just charming jerks that have a hard time forming stable relationships and so keep having to bounce around? The multiple prior partners part of it is probably not going to be the root cause of any unhappiness. And what if the ones with only a single partner weren't actually super happy, but they just stayed with their person because they were terrified of going back into the dating pool, which they never really been in? And what about religion? To give you an idea of just how important that could be, let's take a little look at the relationship between church-going and number of sexual partners. Another mere correlation, but let's look at the different ways that this could play out. Imagine a hypothetical woman. Let's call her Jane. Jane grew up in a nice Christian home in Mississippi, attending church every Sunday. But when she left for college, she started to have some questions about her faith. She spent a few years exploring her wild side and ended up sleeping with more than 10 guys, and maybe one or two girls. Fast forward a few years and she's returned home to be close to her family. She found a guy to settle down with. He grew up in the same neighborhood. They go to church every Sunday because that's just what you do when you live in Yellowbusha. But she finds herself not as happy as she would like. Perhaps because ending one.
Then there were 3 more murders.
What? Let's try that again. Perhaps because ending one. The questions about her faith never really went away, and she feels like she doesn't fit in, and so she's unhappy. Or maybe all her doubts have been settled. She loves her husband, but her husband and neighbors are constantly making judgmental comments about her past actions. I could go on, but in both cases, the real problem is not some inability on her part to be able to properly connect with her new husband due to comparing him with past men.
So if you sleep with one guy, you're going to compare the next guy to him. If you sleep with 10 guys, you compare all 10. If you sleep with 20, you compare all 20.
Let's look at some of the other variables that were studied with regards to marital happiness. Overall, the total difference between one or multiple sexual partners was a 7% difference on the likelihood of marital happiness. That's only 1% more than the effect of religion, 2% more than income, and less than that of ethnicity. Think about how this small effect size would compare to something like actually working on your relationship. Or don't just think of it, and instead look at this 2013 study from Brigham Young University, which did show a correlation between number of previous sexual partners and decreased relationship stability and satisfaction. But the effect size was more than 3 times smaller than that of good communication. So, this and other studies do show a small relationship between increased number of sexual partners and decreased marital satisfaction, and worse marital outcomes. We've discussed some of the confounding variables, but let's talk a little bit more about why this relationship might exist. Don't worry, we're almost done.
Because the more men you sleep with, you lose your ability to bond with each one.
Pairbonding.
Yeah, it's pairbonding.
Is that what pairbonding is? Throwing out scientific-sounding terms doesn't really help your credibility if you don't use them properly. Pairbonding is usually used in the context of animals. Here's an excerpt from a 2021 review paper on the topic.
A pair bond is a selective association that exists between two adult individuals of the same species, and later on, and many definitions require or assume that pairs sustain their relationship beyond the duration of a single reproductive cycle or mating season.
You couldn't stay with me even for one reproductive cycle? I thought we were pair bonded.
I wrote you every day for a year.
So if it's not pair bonding, why is there any effect at all? Even the more elaborate models in some papers weren't able to examine all the confounding variables. But the authors have multiple suggestions. 1. People who have gone through more breakups are less likely to be scared about going through another, and so are more likely to end it when necessary and healthy. 2. Those who are better at making relationships work from the beginning are more likely to stay in the relationship. 3. The adultery effect. Assuming truthful answers, big assumption, I know, only one partner means no cheating. Finally, many studies have found that if you live together before getting married, or at least getting engaged, you're more likely to end up divorced. A recent 2021 study found a 31.4% divorce rate for those that lived together before marriage, compared to 25.9% for those who hadn't. Why is this relevant? Because people who had more premarital partners are more likely to end up living together before marriage. And this could be the reason why that number leads to worse marital outcomes. But why does this happen? One big reason is the momentum effect. Couples that live together are more likely to just get married by default rather than as the result of making a clear, conscious decision, well thought out. But they're also more likely to have done so due to an unexpected pregnancy or financial concerns. So all of this could lead to a less happy marriage, but not because of some inability to form a new pair bond. Whew, that's a lot. So, let's recap by reviewing her 4 claims. First, specificity. Was there any evidence that going above that magic 5 partners number drops your chance of marital happiness from 80% to 25%? Definitely not. But it is true that people who are currently in long-term marriages are less likely to have had multiple sexual partners, compared to people who are over 30 and still unmarried. Second, the gender gap. Is it true that sleeping around is going to be more likely to affect a woman's marital happiness than a man's? Definitely not. All of the observational data shows the same trend for men as for women. But some research does show that men do tend to prefer women who have had fewer sexual partners, because double standards are a thing. Let's recap 3 and 4 together. The causal relationship. Is there any evidence that the very act of sleeping with more men before marriage makes it less likely for a woman to be able to pair bond and form a strong romantic connection with a future husband? No, that's not a thing. But even if there's no 80 to 25% drop, is there any solid evidence that your mother could use to say, if you want a husband, don't do that? The answer is no, with some caveats. There are some relationship pitfalls that those with more premarital sexual partners seem more likely to fall into, or have fallen into, which can then lead them to a less happy marriage. These include treating relationships less seriously, accidental pregnancy, and living together leading to marriage based on momentum rather than a well-thought-out decision. And the effect of things like good communication and good sexual quality have been shown to make a much bigger difference than prior sexual partners within a relationship. I'm Avisha, aka Distilled Science, and I love doing deep dives into scientific literature to find takeaways that we can apply to our own lives. I also love debunking people that give science a bad name. This was my first long-form video on this channel, but I'll be doing plenty more of these deep dives going forward, covering topics ranging from psychology to productivity to exercise and nutrition, all focused on applying the latest scientific research to improve your life and help you make science-backed decisions. Likes, shares, and follows really help me out, and I'd love to hear your thoughts on this video in the comments. And let me know what topics you'd like me to cover in the future.